As you know, we've been talking a lot about safety this morning, and we're going to continue that theme with Dr. Michael Binder, who is the President and CEO of the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission. The CNSC protects the health, safety, and security of Canadians, as well as the environment, and respects Canada's international commitments on the peaceful use of energy. The Commission was established in 2000 under the Nuclear Safety and Control Act and reports to Parliament through the Minister of Natural Resources. CNSC was created to replace the former Atomic Energy Control Board, and that was founded in 1946. Dr. Michael Binder was appointed President and CEO of the Commission in January 2008. Throughout an extensive career in the federal public service, Dr. Binder has held senior positions at Industry Canada, the Department of Communications, the Office of the Controller General of Canada, Canada Mortgage and Housing Corporation, the Ministry of State for Urban Affairs, and the Defense Research Board. As CNSC President, Dr. Binder is responsible for overseeing the use of nuclear energy and materials in Canada. He leads and manages the Commission in order to protect the health, safety, and security of Canadians and the environment, and to respect Canada's international commitments on the peaceful use of nuclear energy. He appreciates the challenges and opportunities of being the watchdog of the nuclear industry, and his avowed mission is to ensure that Canada's nuclear facilities and activities are the safest and the most secure in the world. Please welcome Dr. Michael Binder.
Thank you, Mark. And bonjour, bonjour, madame et messieurs. C'est vraiment un grand plaisir d'être ici aujourd'hui et participer à cette conférence. First of all, I got to test to see if technology works. Well, we'll see in a minute. Just to let you know that as I now start speaking, the deck is on our website in both languages. So, little plug, come and visit. So, it's really hard to believe that it's been a year since I was here trying to explain to you what we do at the CNSC. I must say that it was a very, very busy year. So what I would like to do is I would like to, well, first of all, remind you, and I think Jay has already read, Mark already read our mandate, but I always like to repeat it. Just to remind everybody that we are the safety nuclear watchdog, and our mandate is actually very, very clear, very precise, to protect the health, safety, and security of Canadians and the environment. And to do the job, we actually need a full, we need to have a full functioning commission. And last year, we were really worried. We went down to only three commissioners out of seven. So we were very, very happy when the government decided to reappoint Mr. Tolgiesi and Ms. Arve in October of 2011. And we have a brand new member. Her name is Romina Velshi, and you will see her in action anytime you appear in front of us next. So what I thought I will do is I will give you the CNSC top 10 challenges, events, whatever you want to call it, that we had to deal with last year, in 2011. And starting with number 10, we were celebrating our 65th anniversary, and my stale joke is that we're not in retirement age. We will continue to be around for a long time. And we published our timelines. It's a kind of interactive website, kind of a site, and we invite you all to go in there and play with it, and more importantly, continue to contribute and upload some information, because we're planning to maintain these timelines on our site. So that was number 10. Number nine is our participant funding program, and it's the first year of operation. In fact, I remember that some of my regulatory friends abroad, you know, the US, France, China, always were very, very curious about the program. They don't have any such program. And they were curious about why are we paying for somebody to come in front of us. I had to explain to them this is the Canadian way. We encourage people to come. And I would encourage more people to tap into this program, particularly from some people we don't hear from the academic community, some of the anybody who has any value-added information to share with the commission in our deliberation and rendering a decision, please use this particular mechanism for funding. And in fact, we had in Chalk River, we had some intervention funded by the program in Pointe-le-Pro and in Cameco relicensing. So it's starting, it's a slow start, but we will see how it works. Number eight was the Altona incident. I don't know how many of you know the Altona incident. The issue has occupied a lot of time in our work last year, and that was the uranium spill aboard the ship that was delivering uranium to China. And the ship had to go back to Canada for cleanup. And our staff did a magnificent job in interception, the cleanup, overseeing all of this stuff. And in fact, CNSC was recently recognized by the community of federal regulators for excellence award in regulation for its oversight of Altona incident, of the incident, the Altona cleanup incident. Number seven is the license renewal of Jeanty Deux. And I don't know how many of you watched, it was a very, very lively public hearing in Bécancour, Ontario. And I'd like to take this opportunity to publicly, one more time, thank Madame Pelletier, who was the was speaking and took a pie in the face that was destined for me. So I'd like to publicly acknowledge she took a bullet for me, and thank you, Madame Pelletier. And now, of course, the work has been done, and we are waiting for the government of Canada, the government of Quebec, to make a decision about the refurbishment. And hopefully we will hear the way ahead soon. Number six was the Chalk River Laboratory license renewal. And we had, again, a public hearing in Chalk River. And in September 2011, as you heard, the government announced the sale of the commercial reactor division of ACL to CNC-Lavalin. But the future of the ACL nuclear research laboratories is still work in progress. And I personally believe that Canada needs a very strong center of excellence that is strongly supported by the industry and government if we want to keep up with evolving technology. So we shall see how this Chalk River future will unfold. Number five was the IRS follow-up mission. And they gave us a clean bill of health. In fact, they commented us on implementing all the recommendations from the 2009 mission. But we also asked them to take a look at the Fukushima reaction. And gave us some suggestions, and their report is now in our action. Our action plan in reply to the recommendation will be published very, very soon. And Canada has been promoting the idea that all IRS mission recommendations should be published. They're not all are published, and I think if all countries commit to publishing those recommendations and acting on their action plan, then maybe events such as Fukushima wouldn't have happened. I mean, this is a big assumption here, but I think it definitely will enhance the accountability and responsibility of the various operators across the world. Number four, something may not be of interest to you, but very, very interesting to us. There's a government fiscal restraint ongoing, and like every other department, we are to propose a cut of 5% and 10%, and we will await the budget decision about what will be accepted, what will not be accepted. Suffice to say that whatever we recommended as a possible cut will not interfere with our safety mandate. We were looking for administrative efficiencies, and that's what we propose, because everybody knows we can always improve our administrative efficiencies and the way we do business. Number three was a little file called steam generators. Some of you would know what I'm talking about. We spent a lot of time on this file. We held three separate hearings, particularly to deal with the misinformation about the safety case of the steam generators. And the CNSC staff briefed communities, briefed municipalities, held a special technical briefing on Parliament Hill and on the press. And maybe Jay Ingram view that we were just spinning our wheel because we wouldn't change anybody's idea. Maybe that's another example of that, even though I'll talk about this later on. I don't buy into this notion. Otherwise, we should stop public hearing and we should stop communication. And I think most of the silent majority is willing to listen to science and arguments, but we can debate this, and I'm sure we will in the panel later on. But what came home to me was that the internationally accepted policy of reduce, reuse, and recycle is not really well understood, not well promoted, and we got to do a better job of explaining the benefit of using adopting this policy. Number two, Darlington Joint Review Panel. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. It's already been discussed a couple of times. The review panel filed a report, August 2011, indicating no significant adverse environmental effect if the recommendation are followed, and I guess we're all waiting for the federal government reaction to that report, and hopefully they'll be coming soon. And the number one file that we had was obviously the CNSC response to Fukushima. It was action-oriented. We right away reacted by ordering the industry to take a quick look, the kind of quick lessons learned, and we've created a task force to deal with some of those issues, and we even created an advisory committee, an external advisory committee, to actually take a look at the process. So, it was a very busy year, and what I'd like to do in the, somebody I guess will give me a signal when I'm running over time, which I will, go for the next top 10 items coming at us for the year 2012. And Fukushima obviously remains the number one priority. We are now having in plan a commission meeting May 2012 to hear what the industry is proposing, what the commission is recommending with the path ahead. Hopefully we'll get some action item everybody be comfortable with, and moving on. We also are planning to promote in the Convention on Nuclear Safety in August 2012 a little bit more accountability and having global reporting on performance of the various nuclear, consistent with what WANO is doing. The regulatory community, I think, should do similar reporting, and we will be discussing it in the International Nuclear Regulators Association meeting in April in Ottawa. So stay tuned for that. Our number two is the DGR, Deep Geological Repository, and after a long wait, the government finally appointed the members, and a public orientation session has already been held. I must say that we have an exceptionally strong panel with very expert members, and we're looking forward to some pretty constructive hearings, and I'm confident that the panel will do a really good job. New build. So the way we look at this now is we are waiting for the federal government response to the Darlington GRP, and if it's positive, the panel then will have to consider the application for license to prepare the site. And if that's okay, the Ontario government then presumably will be in position to decide what they want to do in Darlington. So we are now in a waiting mode, but I think this will unfold relatively quickly. At least I hope it'll be unfolding relatively quickly in 2012. While all of this is going on for the new stuff, there's some bread and butter refurbishment that's going on. So number four is refurbishment, ongoing refurbishment. Point La Pro license renewal decision of last week allowed them to restart, which I understand is expected sometimes this year. Bruce A, Unit 1 and 2 are expected to restart. I think they're in the process of restarting in the coming month. And the planning for Darlington refurbishment is already started, and we are waiting for Quebec government decision on Jean Trudeau. In the Canadian uranium, number five is the steady progress of Canadian uranium projects. And it's interesting, you know, there was a blip in the market, but I think the market now is steady in terms of demand. So all the Saskatchewan mines are active, and Cigar Lake is under construction. And but there's interesting new projects coming on from Kigavik, Midwest, Matouche. Matouche, the Minister of Environment, Minister Kent, now authorized the proceeding on Matouche. So that's going to be a first kind of hearing, regulatory hearing, on a mine, a uranium mine in northern Quebec. And as mentioned a couple of times, there was the Prime Minister announcement on a deal with China on uranium. And CNSC and our friends in DFAT are now in the process of trying to finalize the fine print. You know, our fine print can become difficult to close on, and we're trying to close on the China administrative arrangement and India administrative arrangement. Number six is our work to update our regulatory framework. And we've been very, very busy to clarify the roles of the various federal players. So we're trying to get into to strike MOUs with Environment Canada, Health Canada, Transport Canada, Fishery and Ocean, just to name few, who are involved in our business. So there's an understanding on the roles and responsibility, and more importantly, on timelines associated with this. We also issued some discussion papers that I predict will catch your attention. Some of them, like the groundwater protection and effluent release limit, we just issued yesterday, I believe, and fitness for duty and financial guarantees, I think are coming, and I think we need to engage in a discussion about what do we want to do in those areas. And our discussion papers are aimed at exactly that. We really encourage to get some good advice and input from you on some of those regulatory documents. Also, we issued, we've been very, very active about updating our regulatory and guidance document, and I listed a few of them. You go to our website, you'll find many, many more that didn't fit into one slide. And it's basically license application guides and a lot of things to try to clarify the expectation of the regulator. Our number seven is our transportation safety requirement. The IRS, at our request, took a look at our the way our regulatory framework associated with transportation of dangerous goods, and they gave us some suggestions, which we are following up on. And it's obvious now that there's a lot of more interest, public interest, in when you do shipment of obviously uranium, isotope, seal sources, spent fuel, and highly enriched uranium. And we need to be a little bit more transparent as to how we do this. I found out that some of our documents either need a rewrite or more clarification about the actual process. And we are working on this now. Number eight is mission-focused research, and we are focusing our limited resources in such areas as aging management, tritium effect, western tailing management, and we also are trying to understand what kind of there's some research areas we're taking a look at post-Fukushima, such as collaborative severe accident research, better safety analysis tools. And we're also re-examining our safeguard research that we've been working with the IEA and NEA. And we're not doing it by ourselves. We'd like to collaborate with a research institution, ACL, NSERC, et cetera. Item number nine is the government regulatory reform agenda. Now, I'm sure you've been listening to some of the speeches associated with some of the major pipeline proposals. And our Minister Oliver and the Prime Minister have been clear that they believe that some of the regulatory processes can withstand some improvement, particularly as it relates to clarity and timelines. So we expect to see some movement in this particular area. And CNSC is ready to contribute. We believe that there's lots of room for streamlining our processes and make sure there's good coordination between all federal and provincial regulators when consider a proposed project. In fact, I actually like the bumper sticker, one process, one assessment. My colleagues haven't bought into my last one and says one regulator. But that's the kind of things that we are working on. It's work in progress, but I think we're going to see some action on this soon. And last but not least is communication. And here I'm sort of somewhat disagree with a wonderful presentation by Jay Ingram. He used the U.S. You know, the Democrats and the Republican. But if as hypothesis was right, once somebody were, you know, once there was a Democrat president, there will always be a Democrat president, because what happened to the swing vote? And I believe that the vast majority of population is not aware of many of those issues and actually can be swayed one way or another. So he really challenged my values that science and argument and debate do matter. And as somebody in the communication expertise, some pollster who is a very respectful pollster said to me, look, on any issue, there are three buckets of people. There's one with you, don't bother with them. There's one against you, forget about them. It's the vast middle bucket that you want to go after. And it turns out that this vast bucket is probably bigger than the other two, and lots of room for trying to persuade analyze, share information. And that's the assumption we're working on, we'll continue to work on. That's why we insist on public outreach. That's why we have a public hearing. And that's why we invest time and money in being on Facebook. If you walk to our booth, you'll see some new product, CNA2012, CNA2012 online. And by the way, when we say we're gonna do a CNA2012, we have oversubscribed list. More people want to come and listen to CNA2012. Well, who are those guys? What values do they bring to the table? I thought they were thirst for knowledge, but we can debate this with Jay. So basically, that's it. Just to finish with my tagline that we will never compromise safety. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Binder. Looking forward to seeing how this debate and discussion continues. But before we get to our panel discussion, which is going to start shortly, we do have time for one quick question and answer. So we've got a gentleman here, microphone coming towards you right now.
We've all heard that in Georgia, the Vogel reactors got a construction operating license approval. Would you comment on what that could mean for that machine in Canada?
Well, I don't know. You better ask Ontario government and OPG. We, the moment that Ontario government and the environmental assessment is formally approved, OPG will have to come to us with a construction license. And we, in fact, actually in the process of trying to see whether we need to learn from the Americans about whether we need to combine construction and operations. I mean, the idea of awarding a license to construct and allow them to construct and have in Canada happen what happened in the state, that you have something constructed and then not allowed to operate, sound bizarre to me. So we are in discussion about that, and we have some ideas about how to move on that. But we'll have to wait for an application for construction to deal with some of those issues. NRC decision have all kind of, if you're talking about purely whether CNSC should adopt the COL model, the financing of this thing was done by the American kind of a system. The regulatory approval of the technology was done by, a very extensive kind of a regulatory process in the U.S. We will react to whatever comes at us, and we believe we are ready now. We're in a waiting kind of a mode. What irritated me when I arrived at this job is everybody was looking at us as the risk, the regulatory risk. I was always told about the regulatory risk. I'm trying to figure out what the regulatory risk is when we are waiting for you guys. Most of it, what are we trying to do is not only in waiting, we would like to make it clear what is that we want from you guys to get us to agree to what is that you want. So we've been spending all our time to clarify our requirement. And the proof will be in the actual first application that comes to us. So far, we've been successful in reducing the approval times. We've some of our administrative approvals have been simplified. We've reformed our licensing process and the license itself. So, and we haven't had too many noises that we're not doing a good job. I expect that this industry will not be shy to tell us when things get off the rails. So I don't know if I'm answering specifically your question. The American, as you know, the American, it's a state by state in terms of readiness. Not all states are ready to approve a nuclear facility. So it's gonna be very interesting to see if that's a beginning of a renaissance. Remember the renaissance? Right. Is it the beginning of the renaissance or is it a one-off? You can talk to some of our American friends here. They can give you a better answer to that. From a regulatory perspective, in the state, they also, they tell me, my colleagues in the state telling me that they are working very, very hard about approving all those machines that are in front of them. And I don't think they will be the barrier. It'll be really the industry financing and all the nuclear externalities that determine how fast you go and build something.
All right, thank you, Dr. Binder. It's been great to see all the activity you've had over the last year and to also see where you're going. Thank you once again, Dr. Michael Binder.